Hi everybody, Dr. A again with Basics of Chemistry. This video is going to look at the electrolytes. More specifically, we're going to look at sodium, potassium, and chloride. Let's start with sodium. So a normal range for sodium is going to be 136 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. It is the cation found in the highest concentration in extracellular fluid, meaning plasma and interstitial fluid. It is really important in maintaining osmotic pressure in blood and tissue fluids, which is fluid balance. It drives the movement of water osmosis back and forth between cells in the fluid around the cells and then the fluid inside the blood. It is important in maintaining electrolyte balance, which is the electrical neutrality between the negative and positive charges within the cell and also between the cell and outside of the cell. And so you should have an equal number of negative and positive charges inside a cell and outside the cell and on both sides of the membrane. It does not have to be the same type of ions, just it should be electrical neutrality. And then acid-base balance in nerve impulse transmissions are also affected by sodium levels. Hyponatremia is low sodium levels below the normal range. The decreased sodium levels can occur in the following conditions. So severe polyuria, that means producing lots of urine, such as can be seen in diabetes insipidus, which is the water diabetes, where there's a lack of antidiuretic hormone and therefore the patient is producing copious amounts of really dilute urine and sodium can be lost in that process. And so the blood level of sodiums would be low. Metabolic acidosis, as in diabetic acidosis, the acidosis process is going to drive the sodium levels down. Addison's disease, where there's an insufficient amount of the adrenal cortical hormone, especially aldosterone. So the job of aldosterone is to take sodium from the urine that's being formed and put it back in the blood. And so if there's not enough aldosterone there, it cannot do that job, and therefore the patient can end up with low sodium levels. Diarrhea, because it can be lost through the GI tract. And then renal diseases, especially those that would interfere with this normal movement of sodium from the urine, from the filtrate that's going through the tubules. And normally the sodium is moved from there back into the blood, reclaimed, put back into the blood, and until everything is balanced. And so renal disease can interfere with that process. Hypernitremia, or elevated sodium levels above the normal range. This is in blood. These elevated sodium levels can occur in the following conditions. So Cushing syndrome, which is hyperactivity of the adrenal cortex with high cortisol levels and high aldosterone level. So it's the opposite of Addison's. And so there's too much aldosterone, meaning too much of the sodium is going to be removed from the urine and put back into the blood, and then that would lead to high sodium levels in the blood. Severe dehydration, where there's this massive loss of fluid, so the blood is more concentrated. Brain injury, diabetic coma, especially in insulin overdose. So insulin, as it goes up, drives sodium levels to go up in fluid retention. And also in excess salt intake, especially sodium salt like table salts, although you have to take in quite a bit for that to happen. Oddly enough, in the American diet, this excess salt doesn't come from table salt, from people salting their vegetables or salting the food to appropriate taste. It's mostly because of the high salt content of foods such as breads and pizzas and hot dog buns, hamburger buns, and so we consume a lot of those breads, especially highly processed breads, and they have a lot of salt. The specimens that can be used to test for sodium are going to be serum. Serum's typically in a red top. Heparinized plasma in this green top. You cannot use sodium heparin. You have to use lithium heparin because it wouldn't make sense to use sodium heparin to test for sodium because the sample would be contaminated with sodium, and so your readings would not be accurate. It can be done on whole blood. That would be point-of-care testing where the device takes whole blood. It can be done on urine and other body fluids. The red cells must be separated from the serum or plasma to avoid shifts in equilibrium of these constituents between the cells and the serum or plasma. So things are always shifting back and forth, and so it's a good practice to centrifuge the specimens and separate the serum or the plasma from the cells. Sodium is typically measured by ion selective electrode in the laboratory. Potassium. The normal range is 3.5 to 5.0 milliequivalents per liter. Note that these numbers are way lower than that of the sodium, and that is because potassium is the chief intracellular cation. So it is the positive ion that is found inside of the cell, the main one that's found inside of the cell, whereas sodium is the positive one that is found outside of the cell in the extracellular fluid. And so when we measure potassium in the blood, we are measuring extracellular fluid. We're not measuring intracellular fluid. And that's why the numbers are really low. It's because it's actually all inside the cells. Potassium is important in maintaining muscle activity of the heart and can be given as part of the lethal injections to stop the heart. So an overdose of potassium will stop your heart. So fun fact. It's also important in electrical conductivity of nerve impulses with sodium. Hypokalemia, a low potassium level below normal range. The decreased potassium levels can occur in the following conditions. So prolonged diarrhea or vomiting with, again, all that is lost through the loss of fluids, and in inadequate dietary intake. So generally we get plenty of potassium in our diet, especially if you eat a variety of fruits and vegetables. And potassium is largely excreted by the kidney. There's not a good mechanism to conserve or reclaim potassium because we usually get plenty of it, and there's usually not a need for that. And even in potassium deficiency, the kidney continues to excrete potassium because there's not a mechanism to conserve potassium like there is a mechanism to conserve sodium. Hyperkalemia is an elevated potassium level above the normal range. So elevated potassium levels can occur in the following conditions. Kidney failure with anuria or oliguria, meaning either complete lack of urine production or very, very little urine production. And the kidneys, as we just said, normally just get rid of potassium, dump potassium. Well, if they're not working, then that potassium is going to back up in the blood and cause elevated blood potassium levels. Urinary obstructions can do the same thing. Again, the elimination is blocked at a certain level, and so things will back up, and one of those is going to be potassium. And also in renal tubular acidosis. One of the most important reasons for performing dialysis is to remove accumulated potassium from plasma and also other wastes. Specimens used to test for potassium, we use serum, which is a red top, heparinized plasma, lithium heparin, which is a green top, and we can also do it on urine. It is, again, typically measured by ion selective electrodes, same as sodium. It's just a different type of electrode. And for this one, we really need to note that hemolyzed specimens cannot be used. So when the red cells in a sample rupture, which is what hemolysis is, and release hemoglobin into the serum or plasma, it gives it a cherry red color, and that's how we can identify hemolysis. The problem is that potassium, being an intracellular ion, it is contained inside of the red cell. So when these cells rupture, they are not only releasing hemoglobin, they're also releasing the potassium. And so that would make it an inaccurate reading as to what the normal plasma or serum potassium level would be. And so typically the concentration of potassium in red cells is about 20 times that of serum or plasma. And so a hemolyzed specimen is absolutely unacceptable for potassium testing. This little color diagram shows you I created it to kind of show you the difference between, okay, this would be not hemolyzed, kind of a typical serum color, to extreme hemolysis, and that sample would have to be rejected if a potassium test was needed. Last one is chloride. So the normal range is 96 to 106 milliequivalents per liter. It is the most important anion of extracellular fluids, negative ion, and your extracellular fluids, again, are your plasma and interstitial fluids. There is very little chloride inside the cells of the body. If you're wondering what's the negative component, the negative charge, if you will, inside the cells, and that is actually protein. Protein carries a negative charge and gives some the counterbalance of chloride with the electrical neutrality for the negative ions. And chloride is important in maintaining that electrical neutrality. It counterbalances sodium in the plasma. And it, with sodium, it helps to maintain osmotic pressure. So with sodium, it helps control the distribution of water between the cells, plasma, and interstitial fluid. And it is also important in acid-base balance, where it has a reciprocal relationship with bicarbonate ions, which are also negatively charged. And so the decrease in one will lead to increase in another, but basically they can shift in and out of red cells also with carbon dioxide transport and within acid-base balance. And so they can, you know, if bicarb enters the red cell, then chloride will leave the red cell. So that's the chloride shift. Hypochloremia, or decreased chloride levels, can occur in salt loss, like in chronic pyelonephritis, metabolic acidosis, renal failure, and prolonged vomiting. So a lot of those are overlapped with the causes of low sodium, because wherever sodium goes, chloride follows, and so whatever sodium does, chloride tends to do the same thing. And then hyperchloremia, elevated chloride levels, again, chloride follows sodium, so dehydration, same as with sodium, decreased renal flow, such as in congestive heart failure, and again, same as sodium, excessive dietary intake, because the salt that we use in the diet is a sodium chloride salt. The specimens that are used to test for chloride are serum and red top plasma. You can use sodium or lithium heparin. Typically we use lithium heparin, because if you want to test for chloride, you usually want to test for sodium, and you cannot test for sodium on a sodium heparin tube. We can also test urine, and then for this one, we can also test sweat. And so that would be the sweat chloride test that used to be done to screen for cystic fibrosis. It's really an outdated test. It's not hardly done anymore because we have really good genetic testing that's accurate and fast. And so now we screen for cystic fibrosis through genetic testing, and the chloride, as we do as part of the other electrolyte testing, we typically measure those by ion selective electrode. Again, the electrode is different slightly than that of the sodium and that of the potassium measurement. All right, and that wraps up all of our electrolytes. Thank you.